In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
So today is Youth Sunday, so we'll be getting a different perspective on the Bible. We're going to be talking about two Johns today. So in order to help you better understand this, we'll introduce them to you. John of Revelation gets to see a vision, once again, of what heaven is going to be like, and what it will be like at the end. He sees a perfect image of what seems to be paradise. This is described as New Jerusalem. This is surprising to John. He believed he was going to spend his days in exile on the island of Patmos, but God gave him greater things to do and see. Christians at the time were being persecuted by the Romans because of their beliefs, but John wasn't that terrorized. We think of how all things are going to change. We think life changes too fast and too often. We have the blessed assurance that the last change that will ever happen is when we're taken to heaven. We have the assurance that no matter what happens, no matter how many changes take place, one thing is for sure, and that's our salvation.
The John we see in today's gospel lesson is a completely different one than the one we saw with the book of Revelation. Our gospel lesson today took place at a pivotal moment in our gospel narrative. In this lesson, we hear a few words from Jesus to Judas, which he says in the time after he enters Jerusalem on Sunday, after the Last Supper and the washing of the feet. Jesus at this moment knows he has but hours left on earth to live. In this conversation, he tells us to remain steadfast in our love and faith, and that whoever fulfills and keeps his word will find God's love. He says that in those who love and fulfill his words, God will make a home in them, and they will be at peace.
Returning back to Revelation, salvation is described as a part of our faith. Hebrews 11 states, "Now faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. This is what the angels were condemned for." So people in the Old Testament looked ahead to the Messiah who is to come, and Jesus did that. You and I, here today, in the New Testament times, look for the Jesus who will come again, not as the Savior, but as the righteous judge, and we're certain of this. This can be confusing, because the Bible is not always literal. John doesn't mean Jesus will physically come down and take our hand and fly us to heaven, or does he? And that's something to think about. We look forward to the New Jerusalem because the gates are open and God's glory is there. So how will we get in? There's no sign that says pretty good people over here or popular people here. We have a hard time understanding this, because there's a part of us that thinks just because we go to church, we sing hymns, we deserve to be called Christians. That does nothing if we don't believe in them. Some people think we need to be perfect in order to get in. That's not true. God will save you no matter what. The world isn't perfect. We need to know the love of God so we can live better and through Him. We need a solid foundation, and that's what people are searching for in this life. It's like we need enough money, or more clothes, or more objects. So while we're slaving away to get these very things and cement our future, we're losing the foundation of our lives. Marriages suffer from long work hours, health suffers from lack of sleep, and the older we get, the worse our foundation becomes. We need something more solid, something that lasts forever. The only foundation that will last forever is found in John's vision. He sees the kingdom coming down from heaven, and he notices not one, not two, but 12 foundations. So you ask, what's on them? There's 12 disciples' names. If I were to ask you the names of most of them, you probably couldn't name them all. Some are not mentioned more than once in the Bible. The men to make the foundation so strong, it was their testimonies that did. Paul said no one could lay a foundation other than the one already laid, which is Jesus Christ, and that's a promise from God.
Having seen God's vision as perfect in heaven and kingdom, but what does it mean to fulfill God's word down on this kingdom, on earth? Does it mean we hold the door open for someone? Does it mean we try to not yell or honk at someone who's driving really slow in front of us? Does it mean we try to talk to someone new during fellowship time after Sunday school? It means all these things, but it also means something to the people. For example, we hear all the time in the news about people working their God's intentions and words to fit their idea. These range from ancient beer home to violence abroad. I think we need to take a good hard look at what God actually said and what his word actually means. Jesus suffered on the cross and was free from all of our sins. So with Jesus' death and resurrection, you get out of hell with your heart if he's a phenomenal. So God commands us to do good works, not as we ought, but as we are able. Jesus frees us from our sins, so that we are free to spread God's love. Each and every one of us has a very real possibility to help spread light in a dark world. It doesn't matter if you're 7 or 97. Each and every one of us can do something, no matter how small, to make God's kingdom just a little bigger. The younger for our younger crowd, like today. Maybe that means throwing a bottle in the trash or recycling instead of the trash, or listening to our parents when something like that. For our adults, maybe this means reaching out to a family member that we haven't talked to in the scene of cut-off communication. God commands us to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. We can pass on that love that Jesus gives to us, to our neighbors. Maybe the world feels a little bit less like our world, and more like the golden palace we hear about in Revelation.
So to recap, we hear John's vision and revelation of the heavenly kingdom.
We hear John's gospel. In John's gospel, Jesus commanded to live by his word.
The promise in the New Jerusalem is the hope that we have to live out our days.
This vision of hope frees us to live a life of service to our gods and to our neighbors.
May it be so. Amen.